The president has also ordered all agencies to account for all Filipinos in Israel. Are Filipinos, do we have Filipino casualties?
All right. There are about 27,000 to 30,000 Filipinos in Israel, and most of them are caregivers, and most of them are situated further north than Gaza. No, I myself witnessed to that. That was my first diplomatic assignment many years ago, and I remember that Filipinos are very highly regarded in Israel, and we thank Israel for that. So, all right. Gaza is situated in the south west of Israel. So it is in between Egypt and Israeli territory. When you say Palestine or the Palestinian territories or the state of Palestine, however you call it, it's actually two land masses, the Gaza, and the right side of Israel
is the West Bank,
which the religious Jews call the Judea and Samaria. It is ruled by the Palestinian Authority, but in Gaza, that's where more radical elements are situated. But they are elected members of the Palestinian Parliament, mm-hmm. the Hamas, which rules Gaza. So they have long called for the destruction of Israel. So what happened was they entered and. You may say, while we mourn the loss of lives on all sides, on all we are friends of all Arab or Jewish, Israeli, and all the Arab people. There are Filipinos in all those countries. Only a small minority of Filipinos live in areas near Gaza. We are aware also of about 300. Agricultural students near the area, but they're all accounted for. So to answer your question, we cannot yet verify any Filipino casualty, which is good. However, the embassy has confirmed that, and we haven't released the names, there are a few unaccounted for. So we don't know if they are missing or they just lost contact or what. There's about less than 10 Filipinos mm-hmm. are unaccounted for. And I believe news already indicated that the Israeli Defense Force has actually rescued some Filipinos already who were in the kibbutz. In other words, I remember Ambassador Flass, the Israeli ambassador here, mentioning that Filipinos, along with other Israeli residents, and of course the Israelis, will be given protection. So right now, the good news is there's no confirmed casualty or abduction. There's a lot of things being released in social media, and Ambassador Lilo and his team are on it. And of course, we base our announcements on facts, and we don't want to unduly scare people, no? Kung may balita na hindi pa naman confirmed.
Okay, Undersecretary, how does the embassy and the DFA account for Filipinos in a country that's in a state of war? I'm just curious, what's the method? Do you go house to house? Do you call them? So you say there are around 10 that are unaccounted for. Right. How do we do the groundwork on that?
In any country, you have Filipino community leaders. We're always in touch with the embassy. And in countries, special countries like Israel, it's even more the case because it's always very often in a state of alert. The work in protecting Filipinos in a country like Israel is not a reactive thing that when there's a conflict and then you do something. No, it's a 365-day a year job because under Israeli laws, every employer has to give protection to their employees, every building has to have a bomb shelter, and so forth. So what the embassy is doing is contacting the community leaders. And in the case of the agricultural students that I mentioned, I think it was one by one, or at least one representing a number. So they're all accounted for. No? May I, for purposes of kababayans, give the
Please
hotline?
Please do. Uh-oh.
Yes. My hotline number po, yung embassy na open 24 hours, no? Pwedeng tawagin from there, of course, or kung may kamag-anak kayo dito, tapos or kamag-anak kayo sa Israel dito sa Pilipinas, hindi niyo alam kung ano nangyari. Ang area code ng Israel is +972. And the telephone number is 54-466-1188. 54-466-1188. Of course, the DMW, which is also one of the agencies being instructed, has a basic hotline number for any case, 1348. 1348, and somebody will answer that. And that's another way that we contact the Filipinos, because the welfare officer, the OWAS welfare officer, and the DMW's attache would have records of Filipinos with contracts. Of course, yun ang mga dumaan legally, no? So, kunyari, dumaan lang doon as tourist, because you don't need a visa to enter Israel if you're a Filipino. We might not have them on file, but that's another way, through the welfare office. So, please, mga kababayan, no? If you know for sure that there's somebody who's really missing, and it's not because you heard it from social media, right? But you know for sure your kamag-anak is not contacting you anymore, lost contact or what, or you know is in a place like I could name Ashdod, Zedreot, Beersheba. These are in the areas closer to the south. Then contact those numbers.
Okay. Now, reports also have it that there are at least 30 hostages right now in Gaza. We've seen videos of armed men separating loved ones, kidnapping them literally. And the United States has confirmed there are Americans, or Americans are among the hostages. Would we know at this point if Filipinos, there are Filipino hostages, or is it even a possibility?
Yes. Number one, no, there's no verified Filipino hostage. Secondly, is it a possibility? Unfortunately, anything is possible, but we hope for the best. However, one thing we have noticed is that Filipinos who are in the region are well respected. In Gaza, for example, there are not OFWs, but there are Filipinos there, such as Filipino wives of Palestinians. If you remember, there was a time there were a lot of Palestinians who would study medicine or dentistry in Philippine universities some decades ago, and they would bring home Filipino wives. So there's about 150 of them. They're in Gaza, and we are monitoring them as well, because, in light of what Israel said, that they are in a state of war. So unfortunately, we cannot discount the possibility. But again, I don't want to be an alarmist. They're not targeting Filipinos. Mm-mm. As far as I know, they're not targeting Filipinos. They're specifically targeting people who are related to Israeli soldiers. And we hope that there will be a resolution to this. May I say, because I know that, for example, the Israeli government or Israeli ambassador might be listening, that we do condemn these incidents, and we deeply sympathize with you. You have been, Israel has been a friend of the Philippines, and we thank you for the warm welcome you've given to Filipinos. No, as in Hebrew, you say, "Anachnu haverim," we are friends. So, okay. But then we are also friends of all peoples in the region.
Now, the president might be asking the DFA's recommendation on what we can do as a country at a time like this. We have a special history with Israel. The reason we're visa-free is at one point, right? The Philippines accepted Jewish refugees here. We've welcomed them. So at a time like this, I mean, this is the second attack. One was Yom Kippur in the middle of a holiday as well. This is the second one. What can the Philippines do?
Well. Of course, we offer our prayers for Israel. There are many Filipino evangelical groups who are very supportive of the state of Israel. Right now, though, I do not recommend at all pilgrimages to the state of Israel, no, obviously, while they're fixing this issue. What we can do is always to uphold international law, the rule of law. Of course, we ourselves are very protective of our sovereignty, and we do not want our territory to be trampled upon. And of course, when you deal, there are rules of war, and you don't harm civilians. So we can call on people to respect the rights of civilians. And also, something peculiar about Israel, we're not deploying caregivers because the Philippines and the DMW, the Israel and the DMW are still talking about certain
Muslims.
And obviously because of this right now, obviously we're not going to resume talking until there's a more peaceful situation. Another thing we can do is hope and support, voice our support for the process, which is allowing more Arab states to recognize the state of Israel. It could be that that is why the Hamas did this, because they didn't want that process to continue. Saudi Arabia, I remember, was talking about the possibility of finally having relations with the state, or formal relations with the state of Israel. So we join the international community in the condemnation of these attacks. And again, the president has given the order, and we will continue to monitor the Filipinos. Nobody has asked to be repatriated because the Filipinos are resilient. They are sort of used to this cycle, just like the Israelis are, except this was grabe. Hundreds of Israelis dying, and then usually just a day or two or three, and not that there's such a strong incursion. Maybe the people, Filipinos in Gaza, the 150 or so, 150 or 137, it's our embassy in Amman, which is taking care of our relations with the Palestinian Authority. No? Maybe they might ask to go home, and we'll see how, because obviously it won't be through the state of Israel, maybe through Egypt. But so far, they haven't yet completely, the situation hasn't called yet for them to be repatriated.
Okay, now just to close on this Israel discussion, I think the question is for many Filipinos who are watching, many Filipinos are exposed to the central part of Israel, right? This is the pilgrimage. I've been to Israel last Christmas with my family. So I'm familiar with areas where Jesus walked and Jesus lived.
Nazareth, yeah, Galilee, yes.
Yes. So it's like it moves central to north. Now, you having lived there, is there a possibility that the attacks can reach the central to the north area?
Not the invasion, not the original Hamas incursions, but unfortunately the rockets. Some of the rockets are actually able to reach Israel, high north. Tel Aviv is about 70 kilometers north of Gaza. And so what the Israelis do is they have a dome, a defense shield against it. Unfortunately for the Israelis and for, you know, for the peace in the region, there were thousands that were shot at the same time. And I believe hundreds. And they may have been overwhelmed. And so a lot of the southern cities were destroyed. I would say it's like the situation, perhaps Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, Nazareth would be like in Luzon. And then the area is somewhere in Sulu, Tawi-Tawi, Mindanao, that area. So to give a Filipino's rough estimate, of course, we're bigger, no? But something to give them.
Oo, para maisip ng nanonood sa atin. Kasi some haven't been to Israel.
Yes.
Right?
However, there is a possibility of another attack. Some analysts have said it, that the Hezbollah, which is another force entirely.
That's in Lebanon.
In Lebanon. And that's
already the northern part of Israel.
And their missiles would might easier hit Tel Aviv or certainly Nazareth. But so far, there's no record. There's no indication that there's an escalation. We've talked to some Filipinos who said that the last 24 hours, there's no more bomb alert or missile alert. I mean, so it's now a matter of cleaning up and what the Israelis are going to do in their own words to retaliate or to show that they're in a state of war. So we call on both sides to eventually resolve this peacefully. And to respect the rights of civilians.
All right. Now let's move on to another issue. You just arrived from Italy, and right now it seems that there's a big racket that's going on specifically targeting Filipinos, offering them work permits or jobs in Italy. So there have been complaints. The Philippine consulate in Milan has reported that over 221 Filipinos have paid a certain individual by the name of Alpha Asistencia. Filipino Alpha
agency.
Agency ito. Oh, oh. So yeah. Agency ito. Asking for 3,000 euros per head. All right, let's talk about the scam. What is the extent of this scam?
All right. Kasi po, there are what you call brokers or service providers, which in Italian is patronato, which are offices which prepare your papers. It's like in the U.S., and I'm not implying that immigration lawyers are scammers.
Yeah, definitely.
Of course. Where there may be a Filipino-American lawyer.
Yes.
Licensed, who's able to...
Who will assist you.
Yes. That is what the patronato does. Now, the problem with Alpha Assistenza and another agency was they kept collecting money. This was a complaint of Filipinos, and I met many of them.
Yeah.
And they're kababayans... Their kamag-anak here in the Philippines didn't get to Italy. Worse, in some cases, the papers that they received, the nullum ostiam, there are no objection certificates, so that they could present that paper to the Italian embassy or consulate and secure visa, turned out to be fake. And that's why we told them that we are going to, we're going to pay for your legal representation. It's just a matter of deciding, they could decide themselves. Who will represent them in Milan. Meanwhile, here in the Philippines, the DFW...
Sir, yung mga biktima, tanong ko lang, kasi it's the Philippine consulate assisting Filipinos there. But then 221 na nabiktima ng Alpha Asistencia, lahat ba ito nasa Milan, nasa Italy ngayon, or kapamilya lahat ito ng biniktima?
Ang alam namin, somewhere, ang nandun nagreklamo mismo sa Milan, when I was there, were about 70.
Okay. Right?
And they represent more. So when you say 2021, they represent not just themselves.
Yes.
But like one might be trying to get documents for two people or three people.
Uh-oh.
So some are here. Some are definitely here. And the ones here, the relatives here who cannot go, who haven't been able to go to Italy, would, are being assisted by DOJ and the MW filing cases. Now, in pursuit of that, Department of Migrant Workers they're sending a team, fact-finding, to strengthen the evidence. So our intent is there'll be a case in Milan against the Alpha Assistenza, and the case against here, against the counterpart agencies here.
Okay, I don't mean to interrupt. I'm curious, yung 70 na nakausap po ninyo, nung nasa Milan po kayo, so nagbayad sila, di ba? They paid 3,000 euros. And that includes the plane ticket there, or no?
No. It's just
they paid 3,000 euros. And when they got to Milan, USEC,
hindi nakarating sa Milan. Hindi nakarating.
So yung 70 na nakausap po ninyo, kamag-anak yun?
Yung 70 yung nasa... nasa
kamag-anak.
Kamag-anak mga naipit dito.
Oo.
Yes. Okay. So in other words, they're there. They're legal. They're working there.
Yeah.
They hope for their relatives to join them. The relatives are still in the Philippines.
Uh-oh. So I think this news article should be clarified, because when you say the Philippine consulate in Milan is assisting, right, it seems that they're there. So technically, itong Alpha Asistencia, is it based in the Philippines?
It's based in Milan. However, the manager, it's a Philippine-owned agency, and I think it's only three people who are. It's not a big company. It's like just a small office. I think they're in the Philippines. The owner of it, a lady, who the Filipinos are trying to sue, no? However, alam naman nyo, a corporation can also be sued, you know? So it's a separate legal personality. So they just want their money back. That's what they want. They want their money
but
back.
But this is the interesting part. So, I mean, we've been covering this for years, USEC, no? So where does the fraud come in? Because usually when you pay, if you're the OFW, you already have your own ticket and you have a visa, right? So okay. Are you saying even the assistance of the visa is fake?
Yes, it or did not materialize.
Uh-oh.
What I'm supposed to do for you is to fix your papers, I mean there, no, so that your relative in the Philippines would be able to secure a visa to come here or the work permit
but
to come
that's
here.
That's different. Only the Italian embassy will know at that moment in time, right? If you line
yes,
up, they'll give it.
That's why we would like, in fact, may I take the opportunity
please.
To
use the
opportunity now. Mga kababayan, yung process naman sa Italy, you don't need patronatos. You can, if you're masipag enough to follow the regulations, well, partly it could be because it's in Italian language, maybe that's the issue. You don't need to use brokers to submit your papers. And problem is, nagbayad sila. Okay, what the Italians are interested in is this.
But then did these Filipinos, I'm just sorry, did these Filipinos already have a job offer in Italy or they were going there as a tourist and then they would look for a job?
No, they were supposed to go there either way, as tourists or supposedly there's a job awaiting them. Kasi there are Filipinos who arrive there as tourists and get jobs. Let's face it, there's a job market in Europe, no? Hindi na karating eh. It's not like, I think some Filipinos, and I believe you also thought, ibig sabihin pumunta doon, wala pa lang job. No. When you get there, there'll be a job waiting for you, whether it's documented,
basta meron.
Basta makarating kayo, you can find a job. But the thing is, they're not getting there. So they want their money back.
Pero na-reject ng Italian embassy.
Na-reject kasi fake daw yung papers na pinagdasal. So what the Italian government is interested in, according to the consulate when they talk to the Milan officials, is the fraud, falsification of documents.
Yes.
Where did they get this fake approval ng Italian government? It's a fake approval na no objection to go to Italy. They're fake, according to the Italian embassy here and the Italian officials there. So it's going to be a long process. I told the Filipinos there, and we met at the consulate, we're not going to promise you that you're going to get back your money right away. But we promise you that we'll help you try to get it back. And besides, it's two-pronged, no? Yung mga kayo, may kaso dito, tapos yung mga nandun sa Pilipinas, here, the Philippines can file, and DOJ is working with it. But the thing is, you don't need to do it. And I also passed by Switzerland for some migration meetings. The Filipino community in Switzerland also said that the Italian companies are also working there. Like they're promising here's a Filipino in Switzerland.
Yeah.
Now, undocumented.
Yeah.
These companies say, we can give you documents showing that you are working in Italy or legal in Italy. It doesn't mean you have to come to Italy, but you can present to Swiss authorities that you are allowed to stay in Europe. So there is... ang ganyan, mga kababayan din, if there is an offer for you na alam niyong kapag sa batas, that's a red flag na baka ma-scam kayo. Kasi alam naman nyo that you're not going to work in Italy. Or kung, So we're just calling on people to use the regular deployment process. Dito may DMW, EPO is there. So we'll do it. Anyway, our consulate, I know they were subjected to criticism lately. But that's because hindi nakukuha ng kababayan natin ng pera. Remember, we don't have...
But then you're the DFA. Go ahead.
We don't have sovereignty. I mean, when you complain to the consulate, it doesn't mean right away we can do it because we can't We can't.
You don't have those police powers to.
You know, these powers. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. You said it. Yes.
Yeah.
But we'll do what we can for you.
Okay. All right. So just very quickly on this, in the Philippines, what is the DFA, the DMW doing? I mean, collaboratively to ensure that Filipinos, this isn't the first, right? We have Filipinos. What happened was in Myanmar.
Yeah.
Right. So you have these job offers that are spurious, and yet maraming Pilipino pumapatol pa din. So, ano ba ang sistema? Dapat.
Okay, it's not just DFA and DMW, others, including the Interagency Council Against Trafficking, you know, they are working on this. And we publicize the issues. Yeah. But the media also publicizes, and we thank you, because now, here's some good news. According to the embassy in Myanmar, there appears to be no Filipino left who is scamming, who is a victim there of illegal trafficking. Maaring meron nandun, but they're willing to be there. Pero walang gusto magpauwi. So that means there's some success.
Okay. My last question, let's move on. The DFA has announced that the president still has 4 foreign trips until the end of 2023. Now, this has been criticized by some sectors that the president has had so many foreign trips. I'm reading the list of the DFA, the ASEAN Co-op Council, the Gulf Co-op Council Summit in Saudi Arabia, APEC Eco Leaders in the US, Climate Change Conference in Dubai, ASEAN Japan Commemorative Summit in Tokyo. And you may have people asking, is this necessary at a point when we have problems in the country?
I will answer a simple question. All the ASEAN leaders will be in those meetings. Do you want our president not to be there? Of course, that's the COP. That's the conference of the parties, no? On the environment, no? And then the APEC.
Yeah.
APEC. It's always there. It's going to be in San Francisco. There's a meeting in Japan, you mentioned. And this is the first ever meeting of ASEAN leaders with Gulf, Arab.
After the Israel situation, it's more important than ever.
He's going to talk to Saudi Arabia, to the high officials, and we know we have pending issues. So, very easy to demand. If he's not going there, then the Philippines is not represented at the highest level. He has to be there.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much. Always a pleasure to speak with you.
Always, thank you.
Yes, Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega. Thank you, sir.
By the way, thank you for publicizing also what we want the Filipinos to know, right? About
public service.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.